Hey, good morning. It's Paige Browning. It's Friday. This is Seattle Now. We made it through another week. It was less rainy, so there's a new thing people can't stop posting about on my Instagram and Twitter. They're Spotify Wrapped. And it's getting pricey if you want to see any sports game in the city, especially at the brand new Climate Pledge Arena. We'll break it all down with the Strangers' Chase Burns and Jazz Keimig, but first, some news. The Washington State Patrol does not disproportionately stop drivers based on their race. That's according to a new study from Washington State University that looked at 5 years of traffic stops. The State Patrol asked researchers to dig through their data and look for evidence of racial bias, given the increased attention on the issue in the last few years. There were some small discrepancies in specific areas. In King County, black drivers made up a slightly higher percentage of stops, same for Hispanic drivers in Benton County. After a year off, the Emerald City Comic-Con is back on. It kicked off yesterday at the Washington State Convention Center and will bring thousands of people to downtown through the weekend. It's the pandemic version. This year's con is running at reduced capacity. Attendees have to show proof of vaccination or a negative test, and you're required to wear a mask indoors. Earlier this week, Minnesota health officials found a case of the Omicron variant in a fully vaccinated man who attended an anime convention last month in New York. That event drew 50,000 people. And the Bavarian-themed mountain town of Leavenworth is taking things down a notch this holiday season. Starting this weekend, they're doing away with their big flip-the-switch moment on Saturdays and Sundays that did draw thousands of visitors, eager to see 500,000 Christmas lights come on all at once. One hotel owner in town told the Seattle Times, "You can blame Instagram for overcrowded streets, restaurants, and bathrooms that came along with them. Now they'll spread out the magic and keep the lights on all week." Welcome to Friday. It's officially winter time, according to the Weather Service at least, meteorological winter in science speak. And according to someone who's leaving signs around Seattle, the end of the internet was supposed to happen Thursday. Chase Burns is here. He's the editor of The Stranger. Hey, Chase.
Hello, hello, hello. I'm still here, despite rumors that we were not going to be able to do this.
Exactly. Yeah. We're taping this at 12:15 on Thursday over Zoom. So seems like the internet's still alive for now. And Jazz Keimig is here, too. They're the arts and culture writer at The Stranger. Welcome, Jazz.
Hey, thanks for having me on. I'm so glad to actually be here on the internet, you know, maybe for only a short time longer.
This internet ending theory has something to do with the dates being a palindrome, 12/02/2021, the same forwards as backwards. Are you buying this? Is the internet going down?
You know, actually, as soon as I heard this news, I made a pro and con list of what would happen if the internet wasn't here, or just of the internet in general.
Lay it on us.
So I think for pros of like the internet, obviously, it's really great for like interacting with family and like, you know, watching YouTube videos of car detailing, which I like love doing, online shopping. But the cons is literally everything else, you know, cycles of discourse. So I think it would be a very interesting experiment in how we start to re-relate to one another if it goes away.
Yeah. Well, speaking of the internet, my social media was flooded this week with one thing: Spotify Wrapped. People proudly or maybe guiltily sharing their most listened to music of the year based on their Spotify account. Chase, I don't know if you're on Spotify, but if you are, what did you learn from yours?
I am on Spotify, and I use it a lot, actually. I'm also a drag performer, so I use it to listen to tracks that I'm doing for drag. So it kind of stunk because I like just got those tracks sent back to me. Like, it was like, you know what? Yes. Your number one track is actually Money, Money, Money by ABBA. And I'm like, that's not true. It's not my favorite song, but I did listen to it like 77 times this year because I had to practice it. It's not that hard. But the other thing is, it said my top artist was Bad Bunny, which also happens to be Spotify's most streamed artist. And I was like, you know, if someone told me that Bad Bunny was my top artist, I'd be like, I do like Bad Bunny, but I don't buy that he's like my favorite. So mm-hmm. I think there's some like big algorithm stuff going on there. I also just think it's like, it's what I listen to when I write. So I really think that what Spotify Wrapped shows us is sort of how you listen to Spotify. Like I listen to it while writing and I listen to it to practice like drag tracks. So that's what it gives back to me. And in that way it's fun, but it's not exactly like the soul of my music taste.
It's interesting you say that because I was talking to our producer about how when this comes out, it sort of causes me this great stress because I really value music and I have this worry that the list is going to say something about me that I don't want it to or not portray how I thought my year went. I think for you, ABBA and Bad Bunny are not bad top options.
You're right.
But I'm happy this year. I would say my list didn't necessarily reflect who I would say my favorites are, but I learned something, which is that I'm in the top 2% of Brandy Carlile listeners.
Oh wow.
Who knew? Brandy, if you're out there, come on the show. This is your invite. My partner's in the top 5% of Taylor Swift listeners.
That's a really big accomplishment.
I know. I feel like that's high honor for her. So yeah. So that's pretty good. Jazz, I want to know your list and also if you feel this sense of judgment around it that Chase and I do.
Yeah, I mean, I think I try to look at it as data. My most listened song was Need to Know by Doja Cat. I've been a big fan of her for a long time, so I'm not necessarily mm-hmm. surprised by that. And my most listened to artist is this band called Porches, mm-hmm. which is this kind of like indie pop project of this artist named Aaron Main. And so I actually wasn't too surprised by either one of those like kind of top picks, but it doesn't really feel like the most nuanced reflection of things that I like or feel like made a really big impact on me this year. And so I feel like what kind of helps me not spiral from like shame around certain artists not breaking my top five is just like, all right, this mm-hmm. is just an interesting look at what I feel like I'm listening to obsessively. And I think it's just, it's fun to just kind of look at that data, but I don't think it says anything too major about artists that are actually really important to me that maybe aren't on that list.
Yeah, fair. On to some other entertainment news. Crosscut ran an interesting opinion piece this week about the price of going to a sports game. Some of the details were kind of jaw-dropping. You can hardly find a Kraken hockey ticket for less than $100, mm-hmm. and a trip to a Seahawks game for a family of four is going to set you back almost $600 on average. Jazz, these numbers to me are wild. That's a lot of money for one football game, right?
Yeah, I actually come from a family of six. So growing up, going to these types of really big events were sporting events were always really out of reach for us mm-hmm. because it would be, you know, like $600, if not more for all of us to go. Yeah. I don't really go to a lot of sports games just in general, like because of how I grew up. And mm-hmm. definitely, you know, I'm curious to see the Kraken play and kind mm-hmm. of potentially get into hockey. But, you know, the idea of spending $100 for an experience I'm not super sure about, it's really prohibitive for me.
Right. Hard to find new fans when they can't afford to necessarily go to the game.
Totally.
Apparently, a lot of the cost is because we're building more and more fancy, expensive stadiums. Mm-hmm. Climate Pledge Arena cost $1.1 billion to build. Do these prices seem excessive, Chase? What do you think?
Yeah, I mean, I have a hard time ever knowing how much something costs because, you know, I'm like, I'm never going to own a home.
You and Jeff Bezos.
Yeah.
But I will say, I know how, like, food menus work, and I was looking at the food menu at Climate Pledge Arena, and I know that food is expensive everywhere in Seattle, so I don't think this mm-hmm. is a unique problem. But when you look at it, and it was like, there's an Impossible Burger and it's like $15 or like even the hot dogs are expensive. It was like, what is it? They're calling it a Kraken dog for $12.
Oh, it's branded. Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's a Seattle dog. And it's just, I think we expect that food is going to cost this much when we go out, but we really need to find a way to feed ourselves for cheaper. I was just in Portland for Thanksgiving. And I will say that Portland's food is generally cheaper than Seattle's. Mm-hmm. And I think it's a little better. So I apologize for that hot take, but I think Portland's beating us there.
I welcome the hot take. I've heard people compare the two, and some people do say Portland might have a better food scene. I'm not going to get into it.
Right.
Do you think that this is bleeding into arts and music at all? I did have to save a lot of my allowance money to get tickets to one of my Spotify highlights for the year, Dua Lipa. I mean, concerts, especially a headliner, can also be this expensive.
It depends on where you're going. You know, I feel like I felt that big concert events have been really overpriced for a long time, probably because of that same thing you said, Paige, of the venues themselves, especially the big arenas, cost so much to build that there's just a lot of these costs that are going into them. What I really think about is like the smaller venues too, as they're sort of struggling to reopen. They're trying to attract a lot of people, but also since they aren't attracting a lot of people in a lot of cases because of COVID, they have to increase prices in different ways. And so obviously we're experiencing inflation in a lot of aspects of our lives. I just wish I could get a bar drink, even just like a can of Tecate. I wish I could get for like less than $8, you know?
Yeah, because I found that, you know, a lot of the smaller events and performances that I go to, the ticket cost is maybe around what I would expect, but it's definitely the concessions, like trying to get a drink or even like a little bit of food at the place, that has definitely gone up for sure. And I think it's exactly what Chase said, like trying to respond to the increased labor costs and just the, you know, lack of people coming out like they did before. So it's hitting all areas of going out in Seattle for sure.
Yeah, I guess depending on the week and the budget, it's you might have a drink or food at home before you go out to the concert.
Right?
Or if you're really wanting to support, you know, the Neptunes and the Numos and the Crocodiles, you might save up to buy a drink there.
Totally.
Yeah. Okay, one more thing before we go. We asked our Instagram followers what we should talk about today, and one person asked this. David Stewart asks, when is it okay to start playing Christmas music? Jazz, hot take, what do you say?
Oh my god, my super hot take is never. But, you know,
super hot take.
Yeah, that's my super hot take. But wow. I think December 1st, I think it should be okay. I think, isn't the general kind of idea is that it's anytime after Thanksgiving. I think anytime before Thanksgiving, it's offensive to me, except if it's Mariah Carey, because I love her. But I think right now we're totally in the clear.
Chase?
Well, I usually am not really into Christmas, and somehow this year, maybe it's because it's so dark. I've been really into Christmas, although I haven't really done anything, but I bought a Christmas tree. I have not decorated it yet, but it's sitting there sort of bare.
But baby steps.
I will say, I think Mariah Carey has changed this rule, because it used to be after Thanksgiving, and now she has this whole social media campaign around, like, the minute Halloween's over, it's, like, Mariah Carey time.
Oh,
and
wow.
And she has all these memes, and I'm okay with that. I'm like, you know what? If it wants to be 2 months, let it be 2 months.
Yeah, or we could just have all of November be, just dedicated to the discography of Mariah Carey.
Yeah, I am sort of a December 1st is okay in my book. Although I do have a friend who this summer was listening to the Destiny's Child 8 Days of Christmas album. And, you know, it was July and it was fine because it's Destiny's Child. So,
yeah. And I think something about like Christmas in July, it feels far away enough that it's kind of a joke or something.
Uh-huh,
but I think, you know, as
kind
soon as the holiday season starts ramping up, I think that's when I get really like puritanical about when I want to hear this kind of music.
Yeah. Yeah. What do you said that you don't want to hear it ever. What's your thing against Christmas music?
I think it's just the same songs, you know, and it's funny that I'm saying that as we're talking about Spotify Wrapped, where I'm like listening to the same song over and over and over again. But I've never really connected with it, and I think it's fine. I'm just not overly enthusiastic about it, but that's
it.
I'm a Grinch, clearly.
What if Doja Cat made a Christmas album?
You know, I am, you got me. I would definitely be converted. I will listen to any type of Doja Cat Christmas rap that she has to offer.
Okay, we'll leave it there. Thanks to our guests, Chase Burns and Jazz Keimig, both of The Stranger. Great to have you on.
Thanks for having us.
Thank you.
Thanks. Have a great weekend. appreciate you listening. Clare McGrane produced today's show. Seattle Now is also made by Caroline Chamberlain Gomez, Jenny Cecil Moore, Diana O'Pong, and Jason Pagano. Matt Jorgensen does our theme music. I'm Paige Browning.